Recorded Books presents Dogs Demystified, an A to Z Guide of All Things Canine by Marc Bekoff. Foreword by Jane Goodall. Narrated by Brian Wiggins. Foreword. Almost everyone thinks that my favorite animal must be a chimpanzee. They're wrong. Actually, chimpanzees share so many characteristics with us that I do not consider them animals, any more than we think of ourselves as animals, although we are. My favorite animal is the dog. When I was growing up, a very special dog came into my life named Rusty. Dogs can be extremely intelligent. Rusty certainly was. It almost seemed he was sent to teach me about animal behavior. He didn't even belong to us, but lived in a hotel around the corner. They did not mind that he left them at around 6 a.m., returning only for his midday meal and to sleep at night when we told him to go home around 10 p.m. I first met him when I was about 10, and he was my best friend for the next 10 years until he died. I would never have gone off to Africa had he still been alive. I could not have betrayed his trust. I still miss him to this day, almost 70 years later, and in spite of all the other wonderful dogs I have known since. It was because of my relationship with Rusty that I was able to stand up to the professors at Cambridge University who told me, after I had been studying wild chimpanzees for over a year, that I could not talk about their personalities, minds, or emotions, because those were unique to humans. Rusty had taught me long before I began studying our closest relatives that humans were not the only sentient, sapient beings on the planet. Not for nothing have dogs earned the title of man's best friend, or perhaps now we should say humanity's best friend. They have been trained to be eyes for the blind, ears for the deaf, guards for the house. Sheepdogs help shepherds to herd their flocks, and hunting dogs help in the chase. Because of their keen sense of smell, dogs can help track down criminals, find people buried under the rubble of a collapsed building, detect cancer, and predict the onset of epileptic seizures. Dogs can sniff out endangered animals or their body parts being smuggled illegally across borders. An increasing number of dogs are being taken into hospitals where they bring comfort to the sick. They provide companionship for the lonely and help autistic children to read because they do not judge. And there are so many wonderful stories of dogs who seek out help when their owners are lying unconscious or wounded after some kind of accident in a remote place. As I watch the horrors of the war in Ukraine, I have seen cases where an abandoned dog, through death or emigration of their person, has been adopted by soldiers. "He's changed our lives," said one soldier, who was based with his unit in a hastily constructed, damp trench. "He warns us if anyone approaches, and he gives us love and raises morale." It was the same story with a dog who was adopted by people sheltering in a basement during air raids in Ukraine. All those things and more are what dogs do for us. But what about the other way around? What do we do for dogs? How do they want to be treated? Of course, we rescue and adopt dogs and give them homes. A dog with a really good home, understanding human companions, access to the outdoors, and plenty of exercise will be a happy or contented dog, especially if there are two dogs, so they can play and keep each other company. A dog can be a member of the family in a good way, treated with love and respect for their dogness. Others are treated not as a dog, but as a human with furry skin, dressed in fancy coats and jeweled collars. This may all be done with the best of intentions, but is this the way dogs like to be treated? Do dogs like being bathed in perfumed shampoo or having their hair shaped in fancy styles? What of the thousands of dogs who are left alone all day, trapped in a house or apartment 5 days a week, simply to give their owners a few hours of pleasure in the evenings and on weekends, and who are likely to be dumped in kennels when their owners go on holiday? What of the dogs who have very few opportunities to run off leash, to interact with other dogs? And what of those who are taken for walks but not allowed to spend time sniffing along the way, gleaning information about the world of dogs, tugged along with irritated jerks of the leash? If you really and truly love dogs, you need to understand the ways they try to communicate. As Marc Bekoff says in this wonderful book, you need to understand dog to learn the meaning of the communication signals your dog is sending you, of pleasure, irritation, displeasure, apprehension, fear. You need to be able to interpret the expression that says, I want to be a good dog, but I don't understand what you want me to do. Understand the desperate apology. I know I shouldn't mess in the house, but you left me so long and I couldn't help it. Please understand and forgive. Dogs Demystified will help you to develop a relationship that is two-way with true communication and companionship between human and dog. Above all, dogs are loyal companions who give us unconditional love when they are treated with kindness and respect. Jane Goodall, Ph.D., DBE, founder of the Jane Goodall Institute and UN Messenger of Peace. Introduction. A dog book for everyone. Dogs Demystified is an easy-to-read, easy-to-use A to Z guide, or Canidpedia, of all things dog. It largely focuses on dog behavior, what dogs do and how and why they do it, in order to help you see, appreciate, and respect dogs for who they are and not what we want them to be. A large part of demystifying our canine companions is understanding how they sense their world, which is rather different than how we sense our world. And I hope this guide helps you get eye to eye, nose to nose, and ear to ear with dogs. Getting a good handle on what is happening inside a dog's head and heart is how we can minimize the border between them and us. When we can do that, we are better able to help dogs be dogs. To do what comes naturally, in a world where many aspects of their lives are often controlled and compromised by humans. However, Dogs Demystified is really a potpourri. It includes many diverse topics, such as art, culture, ethics, animal welfare and well-being, conservation, and spirituality, and how they relate to canines. Further, as a cognitive ethologist, a scientist who studies the inner lives of all sorts of non-human beings, including dogs, I want to introduce readers to animal research itself. In a conversational, non-technical way, entries explain research terms and how science is conducted, and I cite numerous studies that support what we currently know about dogs. For a list of references, visit markbekoff.com. See dogsdemystified/notes. Throughout, I blend data with first-person stories since I think everyday anecdotes are, in themselves, rich sources of information that often generate subjects for more research. I also bring an ethological perspective, which means I view dogs as individuals whose behavior has evolved over time. I'm also concerned with how dogs adapt to different habitats, including their humans' homes, what causes them to do what they do, and how behavior develops throughout their lives. Everyone knows that domestic dogs originally evolved from a common ancestry of wild wolves, but dogs have continued to change as they have kept adapting to our increasingly human-dominated world. The bottom line is, I hope by reading this book you become more dog literate, fluent in all things dog, and something of a citizen ethologist yourself as you increase your understanding of what it is like to be a dog. Dogs in our world. Hardly a day goes by that someone doesn't ask me a dog question. I find myself saying over and over again something like, "Did you know that dogs do this or that?" Many people are eager to learn more about dogs, about their different personalities, and why they do what they do, and how the behavior of dogs relates to wolves and other wild relatives, such as coyotes. This is one of the main purposes of this book, to answer all those questions about the intelligence, feelings, and personalities, including the quirkiness, of dogs. This book also makes clear how much more there is to learn. When people ask me questions I can't answer, or for which there aren't any simple, definitive answers, I tell them honestly, I don't know. In fact, the more I learn, the more I realize all that we still don't know about dogs, and that isn't a bad thing. It truly reflects how much we're learning, how we need to look at dogs as individuals, and how much we need to appreciate that every dog-human relationship is unique. I honestly get upset when people make categorical pronouncements about dogs, saying they can't or don't do this or that, and characterize dog-human relationships in a narrow, human-centered way. However, my deeper hope, both with this book and when I speak to people, is that increased understanding will foster more caring. A dog's feelings matter to them, and they should also matter to us. We should take the perspective and emotions of dogs into account in every aspect of our shared lives. This applies to training. I prefer to think of training as teaching and educating dogs about how to live in our human-oriented world, which should be done using only positive, force-free methods. But in reality, dogs are always learning from humans. We often place unrealistic social expectations on dogs, especially homed dogs, who are constantly being asked to do what we want them to do. So giving dogs some extra tender, loving care is really good for them and for us. You can't spoil a dog, nor are there really many bad dogs. Most of the times when dogs misbehave, they're simply doing whatever they have to do to be dogs. Training is a form of education. It's not a way to program dogs so they always please us. There's no shortage of dogs who will benefit from humans trying to figure out what it's like to be a dog. As I'm writing this book, dogs can be found in around 64 million American households, which accounts for 53% of all U.S. homes. In Japan, dog companionship is very widespread, and people like to travel with their dogs, so much so that Japan's Shinkansen bullet trains are creating a pet-friendly carriage in which dogs can roam free and relax as they travel with their people. Dogs themselves are a very diverse species. Canis lupus familiaris is the most diverse mammal. As such, there is no universal dog. Further, laboratory studies that seek to assess dog behavior and human-dog relationships can provide limited or even skewed results. Many times, the dogs used in studies are captive, highly controlled individuals in restricted settings, and just because those dogs don't do something in a lab doesn't mean other dogs can't, don't, or won't exhibit that behavior when they're free. This makes it impossible to declare that all dogs do this or that in any particular situation. Overall, dog breeds don't have distinct personalities, but individual dogs do. So don't judge a dog by their cover. Not every member of a given breed will always perform the way people expect. Likewise, comparative research on dogs and wolves doesn't allow us to make reliable species-wide conclusions about the cognitive skills of dogs compared with wolves. A lot of research hangs on which tests are used, how they're conducted, and how individuals are raised. In total, there are about 1 billion dogs in the world, but many people don't realize that only around 20% of those dogs are homed individuals, those cared for by people who, hopefully, provide their dogs with a predictable place to sleep, healthy food, a lot of love and respect, and veterinary care. This means that roughly 750 million dogs are free-ranging or feral and have different amounts of contact, both direct and indirect, with humans. The good news is that globally there are numerous projects concerned with the humane care of these individuals. Of course, some dogs do indeed need us, but many feral dogs can do quite well on their own. What might happen with dogs if humans weren't around is what Jessica Pierce and I explore in our book, A Dog's World, Imagining the Lives of Dogs in a World Without Humans. Homed dogs also lose countless freedoms, meaning they can't always be who they really are. We're constantly telling dogs what they should or shouldn't do as we helicopter parent their dogness out of them. Too much fussing and pampering of family dogs can actually compromise their well-being. In The Book Your Dog Wishes You Would Read, British dog trainer Louise Glazebrook puts it succinctly. I actually got really emotional because I saw in lockdown what we as a society were doing to dogs. I remember sitting there one night just crying. We call ourselves a nation of dog lovers, yet essentially, we're screwing them over. It felt like this really horrible moment for dogs. Along these lines, in her book Love is All You Need, Jennifer Arnold notes that dogs live in an environment that makes it impossible for them to alleviate their own stress and anxiety. According to Arnold, in modern society, there is no way for our dogs to keep themselves safe, and thus we are unable to afford them the freedom to meet their own needs. Instead, they must depend on our benevolence for survival. Some people even wonder whether we deserve dogs. I frequently ask people to cut their dogs some slack when possible because, in our human-centric world, what a dog wants and needs doesn't always mesh with what humans want and need. I often wonder if the process of domestication, which David Nybert has dubbed domesticration, might cause collective trauma in non-human animals. While we usually only consider collective trauma to be something that impacts humans, there's no reason to think it might not apply to non-humans. Often, when we tell a dog they're a good dog, and most people don't say this enough, we're letting them know that they did something we like, not necessarily something that is an expression of being a card-carrying dog who expresses good dogness. Conversely, when a dog does something that comes naturally, that expresses their dogness, we typically tell them they're being a bad dog. This causes problems in individuals, and it impacts the species, since it means we are continuing to select for traits that we find appealing, but which might be highly detrimental to what makes a good life for a dog. For example, I often hear that there's something wrong if a dog doesn't like to play, doesn't eat a meal, doesn't want to go to the dog park, needs alone time, or just seems to be having a bad day. Normalizing certain dog behavior as universal, or being overly simplistic about the reasons why dogs do certain things, is misleading and can cause huge problems. Of course, it is important to note changes in behavior, disposition, or mood, but like us, canines can have good days and bad days, ups and downs. Dogs are not always up and there for us, and that is a normal part of being a dog. In fact, some of this misguided care is related to the many misleading myths about who dogs supposedly are and what they should do, which I address in several entries. For instance, dogs are not our best friends, and they don't love all humans unconditionally. When dogs love, it's more than mere attachment. It's real love. If your dog doesn't seem to love you, there's not something wrong with the dog. Dogs are not unconditional lovers, as they're often touted to be. Dogs have minds and feelings of their own, and they're pretty choosy. Their close association with humans might be because they possess a gene that lowers their stress, so they're more relaxed around people, but that doesn't mean they'll love you regardless of how you treat them. Wild dogs can and do love people, and often display remarkable devotion. Any given dog is not always going to be in the mood to cuddle or play at any given moment. Dogs have different preferences and personalities. In his award-winning book, The Five Love Languages, The Secret to Love That Lasts, Gary Chapman identified five different aspects of human-human relationships that are important for keeping a relationship fresh and growing: acts of service, gift-giving, physical touch, quality time, and words of affirmation. How they apply to dog-human relationships is interesting to ponder. My take is that it all depends on context. Who the dog is, who the human is, the nature of their ongoing relationship, and what's happening at the moment for each of them, just like in any human-human relationship. All five are an integral part of the language of love package, and they're difficult to separate. All are essential and important for staying in love and keeping a relationship fresh and growing amid the demands, conflicts, and boredom of everyday life. In other words, to understand your dog's behavior, you always have to consider the context for your dog. That means paying close attention to who the dog is, who you are, and the nature of your unique relationship. That's why there are so many mysteries and too many myths floating around. Each dog and every dog-human relationship is unique. We can't assume there are quick, simple, cut-and-dried answers to all our questions about what makes dogs tick. In this book, rather than provide one-size-fits-all explanations, I try to offer wide-ranging explorations that convey what dogs are capable of, and that hopefully leave you excited about how much more there is to learn and discover, both about dogs in general and about your dog in particular. Seeing, studying, and rethinking dogs. In order to understand dogs, we have to actually see and appreciate dogs for who they are. We also need to pay attention to how we are looking. Are we bringing any preconceived notions about the cognitive and emotional capacities or limits of dogs? Those assumptions can affect what we see, who we see, and our conclusions. I often encourage people to conduct their own citizen science with their own dog or with the dogs they meet. I ask them to try as hard as they can to see the world from a dog's perspective, or to become a dog in the way an ethologist would. Seeing dogs, rather than merely looking at them, allows us to get into their heads and hearts. For me, it's really a lot of fun to watch and study dogs, and you don't need to be a trained, credentialed, card-carrying scientist. Anyone who retains their childlike curiosity and who wants to know more about dogs can build a database of canine behavior and draw useful, practical conclusions. In this way, dogs can rekindle our youthful curiosity. To help foster this, I've included entries in this book on research terms and methods, which you can try out and adapt in your own ways. Historically, citizen science has contributed a lot of detailed and useful information about dogs, and you can use what you learn to help you decide which behaviors you should encourage and which you should discourage, with the main goal being to allow your dog to be as much of a dog as possible, rather than imagining them like a furry human running around on all fours. Citizen scientists are amateur naturalists and curious naturalists who have contributed to the knowledge base for a wide variety of non-humans. I talk with people a lot when I'm at a dog park or in nature as their dogs are playing, peeing, and just doing what dogs do, and I always learn something. During the COVID pandemic, when many people had to work at home, I received many emails telling me that as people were spending more time with their companion dog, they were learning more about who they were and appreciating them more. One hardcore scientist, in his own words, told me that he came to respect the field of animal behavior more because figuring out what his dog was doing was a challenge, one that was no less difficult than his field of particle physics. Understanding what dogs are feeling is critical to any attempt to figure out why they do what they do. Dogs have rich and deep emotional lives, and we must honor and respect this bona fide scientific fact whenever we interact with them. Treating dogs as if they don't have emotions is anti-scientific, and it damages the relationships dogs form with us and other dogs. Dogs not only care about what happens to themselves, but they also care about what happens to other dogs and their humans. They read us well. What we're feeling goes down a leash. Healthy dog-human relationships are a two-way street and require mutual tolerance and respect, and it can be a lot of fun building and maintaining strong and enduring bonds, which is a win-win for all. We need to meet dogs halfway to build and maintain reciprocal, give-and-take relationships. It isn't all about us. We must learn to know dog, and dogs must learn to know human. In other words, dogs depend on the people who live with them to become fluent in dog, to be dog literate, so we humans can understand what our dogs are trying to tell us. A good analogy is that a dog-human relationship is a puzzle, and our mutual goal is to assemble an entire puzzle that works for all concerned. Of course, the shape of the pieces is constantly changing, and this is part of the game I find especially fun and exciting. The main challenge is fitting the pieces into a coherent whole while recognizing that the best fit will vary from dog to dog and relationship to relationship and even over time. The number and shape of the pieces can vary depending on the personalities of the dog and their humans. Humans must adjust their lives to accommodate their dog's needs, and dogs must learn and unlearn certain behaviors, like peeing wherever they like, chasing, humping, jumping on people, sniffing crotches, and so on, to adapt to their human-oriented world. To work on your puzzle and gain a better understanding about what's happening for your dog, make a list of the different variables and make a drawing of a dog's head, ears, tail, mouth, facial expressions, gaits, and postures, and then consider odors, sounds, and visual signals in the different situations in which you and they interact. One guiding principle for me is that I imagine it's every dog's wish to be able to pee on everything in the world, and it's my job to restrict these peeing proclivities without damaging their dogness or self-image. It can be quite challenging to make sense of the inflowing and outgoing information, but it also can be loads of fun. By doing this, you get to know your own dog better, and they get to know you better, and these shared emotions and knowledge can function like social glue, which is mutually beneficial. Some people might think, "What a pain this is. I just want a dog and I want them to be happy." But in the long run, if you take the time to get to know your dog better, it's a win-win for everyone. Looked at this way, it's a gift rather than a chore. We strip far too many dogs of their dogness, and surely we can do better, much better. Some people also try to strip dogs of their rich and deep emotional lives, which flies in the face of loads of scientific data. Dogs are not simply a bundle of unthinking reflexes. In fact, we can learn about our encounters with other humans by paying attention to how dogs interact with dogs and us. Dog aficionada Sarah Murphy told me, "I have raised 3 kids and worked in multiple high-profile management jobs, and yet I have learned more about raising, partnering with, and working with humans from my dogs than anything else in my life." Of course, I hope this book helps you understand the world of dogs, but I really hope it helps you understand your own dog by inspiring you to get to know them for the individual they are and to build a life together based on mutual understanding, respect, and love. In many ways, we're a planet of and for the dogs. So let's do the best we can, because it would be a lonely planet without these amazing beings. Why do you do that? Questions for our dogs. In November 2021, Jessica Pierce and I did a presentation for our book, A Dog's World: Imagining the Lives of Dogs in a World Without Humans. In the audience feedback, we learned that so many people, even those who know dogs, wanted to know more, and that's partly what inspired me to write this book. Then, when I started writing it, I asked people I knew, both dog experts and personal friends, to share with me some of the questions they wished they could ask their dogs. If dogs and humans spoke the same language, what would people want to know about how their dog feels and what dogs think about us, their lives, and the world we share? What follows is a selection of the responses I received. To one degree or another, as best I could, I tried to address all the topics people raised in this book, even if my answer is often, "I don't know." Personally, one question I would have asked each of my dogs is, "Why do you play so much?" My dogs were all players, and my guess is they would have said they play because they enjoy it, because it's fun, and because they love mixing it up with their friends and others. There are some general trends in people's questions. People want to know if their dogs are happy and content, and what their humans could do to improve their lives. They want to know their dog's history, what happened to the dog before they were adopted, and how dogs experience their own canine families. Some people, recognizing individual differences, asked different questions for each of their dogs. I hope these questions inspire you to make your own list as you explore this book. I also wonder what dogs would ask of us. This is an equally important question to consider. Jethro, the last dog with whom I shared my home and heart, was a large couch dog. Nothing pleased him more than plopping down next to me. All his 90 pounds of muscle and often unpleasant odors, and simply staring at me, as if to say, "What do you want from me?" If he could have, I'm sure he would have sat like the dog in Joan Baez's drawing below, pondering the world and considering whether to write a book about humans. Mark Oada, dog researcher and behavior consultant. "Hey dog, if you were given a chance to speak at the Global Dog Conference, what would you say? What are the urgent topics you would want to discuss with all the dog delegations from all around the world? Mary Angeli, dog trainer. Are you happy? How can I increase your happiness? What are three things you wish we did more or less of? What was your life like before I adopted you? Do you miss it? Sally Benadikar, head of animal interaction and behavior at Companion Software Development. Questions for my dog, Lyra. Can you smell the time of day? Who was the most challenging puppy in the litter you had, and why? Questions for my dog, Draco. How are you feeling differently between when you howl to a siren or when you howl in unison with Lyra when she is in heat or when you howl in the car crate on your way to a run? Did you enjoy spending time with your litter mates in the first 9 weeks of your life, or would you rather have been a singleton? Deborah Philly Bianchi, writer, producer, and founder of the Chaser Initiative. What did you hear, feel, or see to evoke that haunting eulogy of a bark? Backstory: my father, researcher John Pilley, was the parent of Chaser, who was dubbed the world's smartest dog, and the two of us taught Chaser together. In 2018, my father was diagnosed with a rare form of leukemia and went downhill very rapidly. After 3 weeks in the hospital, he spent his last 6 days in the serenity of hospice as he slipped in and out of consciousness. Chaser spent those last days with us, mostly wandering in and out of the room and quietly accepting my dad's outstretched arms for a weak hug. But on his last day, she silently stood up, positioning herself directly in front of his bed. Her tail was down, tucked against her hindquarters, with her shoulders squeezed tight against her chest, and her head was low with her ears pinned back against her head. She stared at him for several seconds and then let out one very loud, sharp bark, standing stock still as she continued to give him the border collie eye. It stunned us into silence as we looked from one to the other, goosebumps creeping up our arms and down our necks. Jack Brooks, Turkish Delight manufacturer and Floppy's human. Floppy, why do you like to eat leaves so much? Mark Dare, author and dog expert. Do you think about your situation in the world? If so, what is it? What is one thing you would change about your life that would make it better? Yannick Ekman, product developer at Cura of Switzerland and former professional cyclist. Why are you always lying down when you see other dogs? Hope Ferdowsian, author and president of the Phoenix Zones Initiative. Sugar, what makes you feel the safest? Stella, how can we make it easier for you to interact with your dog friends? Camilla Fox, founder and executive director of Project Coyote. Moki, why are you itching so much, and what can I do to alleviate the itching? Are you happy alone with me, or would you prefer more dogs in our life? How would you feel if we added a cat to our household? Jenny Gerson, Senior Director of Sustainability for Databank. Kaya, what would your perfect day consist of? How much of what I say to you do you understand? Tom Gordon, Retired Outdoor Gear Specialist. Why do you love to roll and rub your neck on dead things? How do you perceive dogs and their people walking more than a block away when you bark and warn us of their presence? Brian Hare, professor at Duke University and co-author of The Genius of Dogs. What is it like to be so positive? Why does fetch make you so happy? How can I be more like you? Lauren Harris, actress, director, and producer. Can you walk me through what you've been through, having been abandoned by your owner and placed in a high-kill shelter in South Korea? What were your first impressions of Los Angeles and me? Why does it bother you so much when I try to brush your teeth? Jules Howard, zoologist and author of Wonder Dog. The first question I'd ask Ozzy, our lurcher, would be, predictably, is this love? I've thought for a long time about dogs and what we can infer about their emotions and the strength of their attachment by considering their day-to-day interactions with us. Of course, it's clear that they can feel something we would describe as love. The second question would be a little more left field. I often wonder about the emotional responses Ozzy gets from sniffing certain smells. It would be fascinating to know whether these smells elicit in Oz memories of events long gone
as seems to happen in humans.
John Knoll, former global category manager for Pearl Izumi USA. What do you think we are? Big smart dogs? Servants? Gods? Do you understand our affection? What do you wish for? What concerns you most? Why all the barking? Paul McCartney, musician, songwriter, and animal advocate. My wife Nancy, stepson Arlen, and I have a lovely little dog called Rose. She was a rescue, and when she arrived with the name Rose, we thought it suited her and decided to keep it. She and her family had been abandoned on the streets in South Carolina, and the rescue facility had the requirement that the dogs had to be picked up before Friday or they would need to be put down, because the facility didn't have enough money to keep them longer than that. Fortunately for us and Rose, she was picked up on the Thursday by the Animal Rescue Fund, where we finally met her. It was love at first sight, and she went from being a cruelly abandoned dog to being the queen of our hearts. The question I would ask is, who abandoned you and left you out in the streets? Heather McWilliams Miserjewski, avid doggy foster mom, cycling buddy, and marketing director at Tribute Technology. I don't think I have just one question, because I would ask every dog something different. They are all so different. For instance, my current dog, Jet, pretty much tells me things already, so if I want to know something, I just ask him. Our dog Zoe does this thing where you call her and she runs to the couch, where she waits to be patted or picked up instead of running to us. I kind of want to know why. If I truly only had one question, I would ask, how self-aware are you? That question feels really loaded with human and not so much dog. I'm curious, though, because if animals are truly self-aware the way humans are, it should inform a lot of change in our society with regards to how we treat non-human animals. I'd also ask, are you ready to die? Ada Miklowski, dog researcher and director of the Family Dog Research Project. Do you like what you get as food? Ingrid Newkirk, founder of People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, or PETA. We were given a dog named Muffy, who was rescued after 8 years of life on a chain in someone's backyard, appallingly neglected. She came to live with us. Once I picked up a broom and she flattened herself onto the floor, giving an indication of how her interactions with humans, carrying a stick, a rake, a broom, something like that, had been. When there was a thunderstorm, she dug frantically into the bed as if to burrow to China, and even tried to burrow into me, desperate to escape. I would have liked to ask her, out there, alone in your back garden, tied up so that you could not run from it, what happened? Did lightning ever strike close by, or did a tree fall down, perhaps that you are so incredibly afraid, or is that always how you felt? Jessica Pierce, bioethicist and author of Run, Spot, Run. I would like to ask Bella how much of her daily life she would describe as boring. 0%, 25%, 50%, 75%, 100%. I would also ask whether she likes it when we talk to her or whether she finds it annoying. Anne Carver Rose, professor at Pennsylvania State University. How do you feel when I scold you? My question is not about whether she understands why she misbehaved. There is so much advice about this on the internet. It's about how she processes that someone who is generally nice to her can turn around and raise her voice and look upset.
Being an empathetic animal, she knows I am genuinely angry.
Why don't you believe that when I go out, I will come back? Marion Sally, psychotherapist and social worker. What was it like to leave your mother and or siblings and to have them leave you? How does it feel to be told what to do all the time? How do you experience yourself relative to a sense of agency in your life? Margaret Wallace, retired school teacher and Arlie's human. Arlie, when we push up the blinds by the bed so that you can see out, are we putting you on duty to keep track of everything, or is that your choice? When you play with a toy or small squeaky ball as if it's a small animal, are you actually pretending that it's alive and might run away? Vanessa Woods, director of Duke Puppy Kindergarten and journalist. What did you dream about last night? What is your earliest memory? Sonny and Leonard Zinn, owners of Zinn Cycles. Three questions we would like to ask our dog, 11. 1. When you roll in something, what is it that attracts you? Why do you do it? 2. Why are you licking your belly so much? Is it food-related or anxiety? Your belly skin wants to know as much as we do. 3. Why are you so afraid of thunder and fireworks? Is there more than the CBD and thunder shirt we could do to support you through these events? Where to find references and notes. This book is based on a good deal of science, and readers can find the references at markbekoff.com. See dogsdemystified/notes. A. Abnormal behavior. This could be any problematic behavior that falls outside of what we normally might expect. When identifying abnormal dog behavior, a good deal hangs on the words normal and expect. What we might label as normal can vary by breed, context, and individual. We need to be very careful in labeling something as abnormal by normalizing behavior, because we know that dogs and many other animals show great variability in behavior depending on context, including what's happening around them, who's there, and where they are. Abnormal could refer to unusual or excessive behavior, such as aggression or barking, but often, when a dog is doing something we call abnormal or excessive, it might be just what one would expect when different aspects of context are considered. Their behavior might be entirely dog-appropriate. Butts and noses are very important to dogs, and we need to consider the dog's point of view. One very large study of 4,114 dogs and 2,480 guardians, titled Demographics and Comorbidity of Behavior Problems in Dogs, reported that 85% of people living with dogs experienced behavior problems, including fear/anxiety, aggression, jumping, excessive barking, coprophagia, obsessive-compulsive or compulsive behaviors, house soiling, rolling in repulsive materials, overactivity or hyperactivity, destructive behavior, running away or escaping, and mounting or humping. Of course, these can be problematic behaviors, such as what people sometimes call excessive barking. However, if we consider what a dog is thinking or feeling, what we call excessive might be entirely dog-appropriate to the particular situation at hand. The bottom line is simple. We must consider what's happening in a dog's head and heart and take their perspective, the point of view of each unique individual. Dogs will bark in situations in which it seems to us that barking is unnecessary or over the top. They may be smelling, hearing, or seeing something of which we are totally unaware, or simply be feeling down and out or afraid. Perhaps they are having trouble figuring out what's happening and are scared out of their mind. Or maybe they had a bad dream, which is quite possible. See also barking, dreaming, humping, rolling in stinky stuff. Abuse. Dogs suffer a good deal of abuse in our world, which includes neglect, dog fighting, obesity, use in research, and many other examples. For instance, beagles have been force-fed fungicides because animal testing is required in Brazil. Breeding facilities are also guilty of rampant abuse. Dogs who are rescued from laboratories and breeding facilities need a lot of care and love when they are rehomed. In early July 2022, more than 4,500 beagles were freed from a laboratory in Virginia by the order of a district court judge. Unfortunately, humans are not always a dog's best friend. See also Best Friends, Dogs as Our, Scientific Research, Dogs Used In. Accomplishment, sense of. When dogs do something good or have something that makes them or us happy, I often wonder if they feel a sense of accomplishment. Perhaps they're proud of themselves. After he found some treats I had hidden on my mountain property, one of my dogs, Jethro, would parade around with his head and tail held high, either chewing or playing with a piece of food in his mouth. He did this especially when other dogs were around to see him. Was he proud and showing off and saying something like, "Look what I have, aren't I cool?" I also remember one of my friend's dogs who was a master frisbee catcher. He would run at blazing speed, tracking a frisbee and jumping and catching it in midair, and right after he landed, he would run back to us and proudly parade around with his catch, head held high as if saying, "Look what I just did."
Crows also may engage in similar behavior. Someone once said to me, "If crows do this, then surely dogs can too."
Well, yes and no. The person assumed birds must be dumber than dogs. They're bird brains, after all. And he didn't realize that crows are very bright and emotional birds who play and grieve. However, I feel comfortable saying that when the proper studies are done, we'll learn that dogs and other non-human animals feel a sense of accomplishment.
Acting like an animal. A demeaning expression usually implying that a person is doing something that's below them. The phrase is often used when a person acts with excessive violence or is eating in a wild or gluttonous manner. The expression does a disservice to non-human animals, including dogs, who commonly exhibit a wide range of positive pro-social behaviors such as compassion, cooperation, empathy, fairness, and justice. In fact, humans tend to be more violent and xenophobic, or afraid of strangers, than other animals in many situations.
Acting out.
We rarely think of dogs or other non-humans throwing fits and having temper tantrums out of anger or frustration, but there's no reason to think that other animals don't occasionally act out, just as humans do, to relieve tension or to send a message that they are highly stressed.
Activity patterns.
The different patterns of behavior dogs perform throughout the day and night. Activity patterns are strongly affected by people, particularly helicopter humans. For example, we tell dogs when they're allowed to eat, pee, poop, play, and walk, and who they're allowed to interact with and where. See also helicopter parenting.
Adaptability.
When a dog alters their behavior to accomplish a goal, Donald Griffin, often called the father of cognitive ethology or the study of animal minds, suggested that flexibility in behavior is a marker of consciousness, since an individual has to think through what is happening, think about what they want to happen in the future, and adjust their behavior accordingly. That is, adaptability is the opposite of hardwired thinking, or performing an action or string of actions without considering the impact of what is being done and what might result in the future. See also, learning. Ad libitum sampling. A research sampling technique in which a person tries to record everything an individual does, often including what others are doing to that individual. In the best of all possible worlds, this would be the research method of choice, and using video to record who's doing what to whom can produce these data. See also research techniques.
Adolescence.
The period of life between puberty and adulthood. For dogs, adolescence can extend from around 6 to 8 months to 2 to 3 years. Dogs might show an extended period of adolescence when compared to their wild relatives, especially when there are humans around to make life easier by providing shelter, food, and medical care. Dogs, like humans, can get difficult when they reach adolescence. In one 2020 study, Lucy Asher and her colleagues learned there was an association between earlier puberty and an insecure attachment to a human carer. When dogs reached puberty, they were less likely to follow commands given by their carer, but not by others. They also wrote, "Conflict behavior is associated with less secure carer attachments during an adolescent phase, because behavior indicative of insecure or anxious attachments was only associated with obedience at an age that corresponds with adolescence." Barbara Natterson Horowitz and Catherine Bowers, authors of Wildhood, The Epic Journey from Adolescence to Adulthood in Humans and Other Animals, call adolescence wildhood, which is a tumultuous time ruled by the teenage brain across many different species. Human teenagers can experience or suffer from anxiety, suicidal tendencies, sexual vulnerability, and dangerous risk-taking, but research is showing that rodents, dogs, and numerous wild species experience behavioral disturbances during adolescence
that can reduce their survival later in life. See also developmental stages. Adopting a dog. Choosing to share your life, home, and heart with a dog is a huge decision and a life changer that shouldn't be taken lightly. One UK study showed that nearly 20% of dog owners thought that raising a baby is easier than training a puppy, with the first 2 years being the most difficult. Knowing what to expect and learning the basics of dog behavior can go a long way toward helping make the journey much less difficult. Numerous people also don't anticipate the financial commitment of living with a dog. When times are tough, as many as 50% of dog guardians worry about providing adequate veterinary care to their canine companions, and a large number worry about affording dog food. When people can't make ends meet when living with a canine companion, relinquishment occurs at higher rates than usual. Upward of 23 million American households adopted a companion animal during the COVID-19 pandemic, around 20%. In Canada, around 900,000 people became new pet owners during the pandemic, in many cases as accessories. In 2019, nearly 400,000 shelter dogs were euthanized across North America, and the number of surrenders skyrocketed. Many shelter dogs experience high levels of stress, as evidenced by higher levels of the stress hormone cortisol in their urine. During the pandemic, when many people worked from home, around 70% of people found working at home and training a dog was much trickier than they thought it would be. However, data from the APA National Pet Owners Survey in 2021 to 2022 showed that 71% of dog owners in the United States would be likely to take a remote job over an in-person one to be able to effectively look after their dog. Around one-third of dog owners would consider changing their job if they were not allowed to bring their dog to the office. And 44% of pet parents would not accept a new role if they did not allow dogs in the office. In addition, 75% of people who live with dogs choose dogs in the office over unlimited vacation. An excellent guide for raising a puppy using force-free, positive methods is How to Raise a Puppy by Stephanie Rousseau and Turid Ragas. See also Pandemic Puppies. Aerobic and anaerobic exercise. Cardiovascular conditioning that uses oxygen, aerobic, or produces energy without using oxygen, anaerobic. Dogs, like other animals, including humans, engage in both types of exercise. For wild animals, both are important to survive when they must find food or a place to live and possibly defend those things from others. See also exercise. Effective dog behavior, or ADB. A training approach based on the rich and deep emotional lives of dogs. Emotions affect behavior. Understanding basic human and canine neurobiology can greatly help us in working with another species. Since the canine brain and human brain are very similar, effective dog behavior training is all about mental health, emotional and physical safety, and social and emotional connections. ADB does not use rigid protocols or particular methods, as these are mostly created with the human, not the dog, in mind. Additionally, dogs have their own individual protocols for dealing with the ups and downs of life, and most human protocols don't consider the dog's internal processes. Ideally, your dog will look to you to feel safe. If a dog is triggered, it means they do not feel safe in that moment. We can't undo the past by protocol. But we can help dogs feel safe in their own way with our emotional support and recover together afterward. ADB is not a training program, but an educational program. More emphasis is placed on connection than on changing behaviors, simply because many so-called problem behaviors either become less of an issue or are greatly eliminated once a dog feels heard, wanted, or acknowledged. The need for connection is innate. And even millions of years of evolution have not undone something that has served social animals so well. ADB looks at internal processes to learn why and how behaviors happen, and it emphasizes the importance of all 7 of the primary emotional systems identified by neuroscientist Jock Panskep. The understanding is that when a dog goes into a non-social state of fear or rage, it is due to an unmet need. And this state is only temporary before the brain will go back to being more social. Thus, this training helps the dog want to be more social again on their terms and their time. None of these internal processes can be switched off, and coping is up to the individual, yet it's easier with a friend. If dogs are being coerced to suppress their emotions, they don't have much room to express themselves. See also Hierarchy of Dog Needs, Training. African wild dogs, Lycaon pictus, also called African hunting dogs or painted dogs. Age, calculating a dog's.
Many people try to translate a dog's age into human terms, but it's not as straightforward as it's often made out to be.
You can't simply multiply a dog's age by 7, as is often suggested. A dog's size is important to consider. For example, it's estimated that a small 10-year-old dog would be similar to a 56-year-old human, whereas a large 10-year-old dog would be similar to a 66-year-old human. See also life expectancy. Agency. Allowing an individual dog the freedom to make their own choices. Jessica Pierce notes, "If I could identify the single most significant problem facing home dogs right now, it would be lack of adequate agency. Dogs have very little control over their sensory environment, their social interactions, and the basic elements of daily survival, all of which are orchestrated by human guardians. This lack of control, a near total loss of agency, has significant fallout for their physical and especially their psychological well-being. Fortunately, there are many ways to allow dogs and other animals to have more control over their lives and to empower them. See also consent, personhood. Aggregation. An unorganized group of individual dogs. Individuals may be attracted to a particular location because there's food or shelter, or they feel safer and more protected in a group, but they don't necessarily work together as a coordinated unit like a wolf pack. Aggression. Some people differentiate between offensive aggression, in which a dog attacks another dog for no apparent reason, at least to us, and defensive aggression, which occurs when an individual defends themselves when they are threatened or attacked. Breed is not the only predictor of aggression or of competitive, hostile behavior. An email I received from Sarah shows that often it's very difficult to figure out what is actually happening in a dog's mind when they behave aggressively. I was wondering if I could have some more insight into dog behavior from your perspective. I'm a dog trainer now, but I have 2 male dogs of my own who absolutely despise each other. They're both unneutered, so I know that plays a role, but it's strange because they have no problems with any other unneutered dogs. They will go into each other's rooms, where the crates are, and antagonize each other. If my corgi even thinks my German Shepherd is being let out, he goes crazy. There hasn't been any trauma since I've had them as puppies, and they used to get along. What could cause this? Unfortunately, I wasn't able to offer any specific advice. It's impossible for me to say anything without seeing it in person, or in dog, as it were, and even then it can be difficult to know. I don't know whether being unneutered was significant, and my advice was to seek out a force-free positive trainer, someone who could see what was happening and make suggestions. Agility training. This refers to teaching dogs to run a predetermined obstacle course in a set amount of time. I've been told that many, if not most, dogs enjoy agility training because it provides exercise, it enriches their lives, and it's fun. Nevertheless, there are risks of which people should be aware, such as the dog twisting an ankle or shoulder. One study showed that 41.4% of almost 4,200 dogs who engaged in agility training suffered injuries, of which 15% were severe and lasted more than 3 months. Agonistic behavior. Behavior seen in aggressive and defensive encounters. These include fighting, threatening, submitting, appeasing, and fleeing. Agoraphobia. I've known a few dogs who seemed afraid of being outside and hesitant to leave a small room. All of them had been rescued from abusive laboratory situations, and all but one eventually stepped outside, explored here and there, and felt comfortable doing so from that point on. A few people thought that a dog's refusal to go outdoors was abnormal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.